Our call to worship comes from Psalm 150. This psalm is so beautiful, I've decided to read the whole psalm. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and the lyre. Praise Him with tambourine and dancing. Praise Him with the strings and pipe. Praise Him with a clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The psalmist says to us, we must praise the Lord. We must praise Him with the drum, with a stringed instrument, with the lyre, with cymbals. But let us praise Him with our voice as we proclaim that He takes an interest in us, this almighty great God. And can it be that I should gain?
Sing with me, and can it be? And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died He for me, who caused His pain for me, who hid Him to death pursued.
Well, hello everyone. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our service today, our worship service where we've gathered to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Truly, what a celebration it is that our Lord God loves us so much that he sent his Son to die upon a cross that he may conquer death, so that we could be resurrected in him. But before we continue, may I first ask and inquire how you are doing? Are you still coping with everything that is going on around us with the COVID? And I see that the numbers are climbing again. But you know what? We must not become despondent, because God is in control and it is his will that will be done. Folks, it's an honor and a privilege to be with you once again as we've gathered to worship, to praise, and just become quiet before Almighty God today. So let us do what we came to do today, and that is exactly what I said. Our gospel reading comes from John chapter 20. And I'm reading verses 19 to 31. Verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. I only read thus far. Our God is so wonderful, and the greatest thing of him is that he always remains the same, and he is worthy of our praise. Let us join together in singing that wonderful song, "O Ancient of Days."
Oh yes. Before the ancient of days,
Folks, please join me as we come before the Lord in prayer. Come, let us pray. O dear Lord God and Heavenly Father, O Lord, we greet you this morning, Lord, as we come into your presence with singing, rejoicing, and celebrating, Lord. Exactly like the psalmist said, praise the Lord, and so we praise you, Almighty God. Oh yes, Lord God, truly we have reason to celebrate because our God is the risen Lord. He's conquered death and he has set us free. It is your eternal throne that we approach today, proclaiming that you are the God of gods and the Lord of lords. And yes, Lord Jesus, you are our Redeemer. And it's you that we bend the head and bow the head and bend the knee as we praise you and worship you today. But Lord, as we come ecstatic as we are, we also know that in a week gone by we have sinned against you, and we need to come clean with you, Lord. We need to confess our sins. So Lord, we want to offer you our personal and individual confessions in our silence. So Lord, we pray in our silence, just hear our hearts right now. Oh dear Lord God, we've emptied our hearts before you, and we pray, dear Lord God, that you will forgive us our sins, Lord, because, Lord, you have promised that if we do repent, you will forgive us. And Lord, this morning we proclaim that we've been forgiven by Almighty God in Jesus' name. Oh yes, Lord, it is through your Son, through his death and through his resurrection, that we can approach your eternal throne, knowing that we've been resurrected in Jesus, your Son, our Lord God, our Redeemer. Oh Lord, we thank you and we praise you and we worship you that we are able to atone for our sins simply by coming to you in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, we thank you that you're a God that loves us. We thank you that you do forgive us. We thank you, Lord God, that you're always there for us. So, Lord, as we come now, we just want to pray that you will just be with us in our service, that you will just hold each and every one of us very tightly. Embrace us with your love. Embrace us, Lord, so that we can truly feel your presence, that we can hear you speak to us, that we will feel the warmth of your love, hear your heartbeat in our ears. And we just pray your blessing upon our service. So, Lord, we pray this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our next reading comes from the book of the Acts of the Apostles. And I'm reading from chapter 5, verses 27 to 32. Verse 27. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name," he said. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." I read only so far. May the Lord bless his holy word to us today. As we prepare ourselves for the message, let us just acknowledge what Jesus has done for us in worshipfully singing, "Above all powers, above all kings, crucified, he laid behind the stone, like a rose trampled on the ground." Let us sing together.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified and laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and all wealth and treasure.
Come, let us pray. O dear Lord God and Holy Spirit, dear Lord Jesus, we have gathered today, Lord, to hear your word to us, to hear what it is that you want to say to us. So, dear Lord God, as we come now, we just pray that you will speak to us, that you will teach us, that you will touch our hearts and our minds, that you will open us up to be receptive to your word. O Holy Spirit, I pray that you will use me so that I can communicate on your behalf. But Lord, I pray that each and every word that flows from my mouth will be your words and that they will bring you honor and glory at all times. So Lord, we pray, be with us now as you speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Folks, last Sunday we celebrated the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I emphasized last Sunday that one of the greatest things, if I may use the word thing, that Jesus did is he descended into the depths of the earth to conquer death, to conquer sin. So that he has both control over good and evil. I also said that through his resurrection, in our belief in the resurrection, we believe that we are resurrected to life again. Remember, when Jesus put the curse on the world, he said that we will all die. But through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, to those who believe in him, it gives us a new life. We get resurrected from that dead to being living people in the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And of course, that comes with its implications of changing our situation, changing our experiences, changing our circumstances, changing our wisdom of life, and changing the way we approach life. But in today's texts that we read, there are wonderful promises that Jesus has made to us. And I want us just to look at those very briefly today. You know, reading through this text, we read of Thomas doubting, using the terms, unless I put my fingers in his hands. In other words, Thomas doubts that Jesus is alive when the disciples tell him, and he says he wants to put his fingers in the wounds. In other words, where the nails went through Jesus's hands into the cross. And unless he is able to put his hand into the side of Jesus where the Roman soldier stabbed Jesus with a spear. Only if he could do that will he believe that Jesus is alive. Now, folks, very many of us refer to doubting Thomas, and when we do that, we have a very negative connotation to it. And very often, when we have that negative connotation, we believe Thomas is guilty of something. And you know, when we go through, those of you who know the book of John very well, his gospel, you'll record in chapter 14, Jesus talks and he sits down with his disciples. And he tells them of his imminent death that's on its way. And he says to them that he is going to die. And funnily enough, Thomas, again, is the one that doubts. Because Jesus asks the question and he says, "You know the way to where I'm going." And Thomas is the one that says, "Lord, we don't even know where you are going, so how must we know the way?" So again, Jesus here emphasizes the doubt in Thomas's mind. But folks, I want us this morning to approach it slightly differently. I want us to take our negative connotation we have of Thomas, and I want us to approach it slightly differently. It is highlighted in the passage of John that he brings hope to the doubters. Why does he say this if Thomas's doubting is negative? You see, there must be much more to this than meets the naked eye. So I want to just let us go into this for a little bit and then have a look at this. And I hope that what I want to say might just change your opinion of Thomas. But let me ask you this question. If somebody that you loved very much that has passed away, maybe your husband, maybe your wife, or a child, or a brother, or a father, or a mother, if I had to come to you and say, "That person is alive," how would you respond? Would you not respond in a manner very similar to Thomas? Would you not say to me, "John, you're crazy. I will not believe this because I buried him or I buried her." And the reason you would respond in this manner is because you were scared of getting hurt. Can you recall when you lost your loved one? It was agony. It was pain. And you didn't quite know how to handle that. But with the help of God, you managed to process it and you managed to live with it. And your heart was shattered. And you know what? I believe that if I came and said that that loved one of yours was alive and you could see him or her, to protect your heart, you would respond in a manner and saying, "I don't believe it," or "You're crazy." Because you do not want to go through the same agony that you went through the last time. So I guess what I'm trying to say to you, is it not possible that Thomas's doubt was an honest doubt? And he doubted in believing that Jesus was alive because he had already mourned. His heart has already been shattered in the death of Jesus. And he says, "Unless I can put my finger in the wounds in his hands or my hand in the side of Jesus, I will not believe." Because he's scared that if he just takes it at face value, he will get hurt again. You see, so in the passage where Jesus says he brings hope to the doubters, it is a hope for honest doubt. Because Thomas didn't have any malicious intentions in his doubts. And folks, I want to say to you that if our doubts in Jesus are there sometimes, and I know they are, because I believe if you don't doubt, that you would not be human. And it's okay. It's okay to doubt now and again. But it's in those times of doubting, the honest doubt, without wanting to be malicious, the honest doubts that Jesus intends here. If those doubts are honest, ask Jesus to help you, because he says there is hope for those that doubt. So I want to say to you this morning that if you do doubt, don't let it worry you, but rather allow Jesus to touch you afresh. But you know, there's another part in this passage that I want to say to you this morning, that we need to ask Jesus for help. You know, and very often when we doubt and we put a negative connotation to that doubt, it very often brings feelings of guilt. And you know, guilt, as I've mentioned many times before, is one of the main pillars of psychosis. But Jesus, yes, says, I bring peace to the guilty. And in this passage, we are referring here to two specific disciples. We are referring to Thomas, because he doubted and he thought he was guilty for doubting. He brings peace to him and he says, it's okay, but do not guilt anymore, because I give you peace and that you could live with that. You see, folks, when we doubt, we often believe we are not correct and we feel guilty about it. And that guilt has a result that deprives us of our relationship with God. It deprives us of receiving what Jesus intended for each and every one of us, to be resurrected, a new creation in Jesus, so that we can live our lives to the fullest. That we can have joy out of life and not just live in the depressed and live in the negative, because he's given us peace. You may say to me, John, you know, very often I doubt. I doubt my faith. I doubt Jesus. I doubt whether I am suitable to be a Christian. Well, I want to say to you, let's move on from Thomas. Let's have a look at Peter. What did Peter do? It was even worse for Peter, because Peter publicly denied Jesus three times, just as Jesus had foretold. He prophesied and he said, Peter, you are going to deny me. And yet Peter is the one that took out his sword and struck the Roman soldier. He cut his ear off. And he says, never, Lord, I will never do that. Only to deny him three times, just as Jesus had predicted. But what does Jesus do? Jesus doesn't turn away from him. Jesus doesn't say, no, I don't want you anymore because you denied me. No. You know what Jesus does? Jesus takes Peter and he says to Peter, on you, Peter, will I build my church. Hey? Peter, whom we believe is the guilty of guilties because he denies Jesus, Jesus says, I will build my church on you. Because why? Because Jesus knows we are human and that we are fragile and that we can break very easily. He knows that. And when Peter realizes he denied Jesus, what does he do? He responds in a manner where he asks forgiveness. He acknowledges his sin. And then Jesus greets him and he says to Peter, "Peace be with you." In other words, I bring you peace. You are forgiven. Don't let it worry you. I want to use you. You see, folks, very often in our lives, when we've done something wrong, we allow that guilt to ride us into the ground. And we believe that Jesus is not even going to look at us. And I've spoken on this before, and I say it to you again, and I cannot stress the fact enough that Jesus does not want you to walk around with that emotion of guilt, but rather he wants you to forgive yourself because he has already forgiven you, because he loves you. Just like he did with Peter. He denied Peter. Peter denied Jesus, but Jesus never denied him. Despite that, he took him, and Peter became the foundation of Jesus' church. It is Jesus that turned and said, "Peter, I forgive you." Now just think, how much more doesn't Jesus want to forgive you so that you can rid yourself of whatever it is you believe you've done wrong? Folks, rid yourselves of that guilt. Rid yourselves of everything you believe is wrong. But folks, there's another point in this text that I haven't referred to yet, and something you need to take cognizance of. That point is the point that Jesus says you have a responsibility. We as believers have a responsibility to Jesus. Now, there's just two points I want to highlight in my message today. And the first one is, we have a responsibility to maintain our relationship with Jesus Christ, and not just maintain it, but also strengthen it, to make sure that our relationship is not gone. Classic example. Thomas, what happens when his eyes are opened and he is able to put his finger into the wounds of Jesus, or his hand into the side of Jesus? What happens? He doesn't say, "Oh, okay, that's fine, thank you," and turn around and walk away. No, he doesn't. He reclaims and he exclaims out loud, "My God and my Lord." This is what he says. And he follows Jesus. What does Peter do? Peter, who's denied him, Peter, who should have all the guilt that everybody has, he doesn't just turn around, walk away, and do what Judas did and went and committed suicide. No. Peter immediately asks for forgiveness. And as he asks for forgiveness, he knows he is forgiven, because he maintains his relationship with Jesus Christ. He has witnessed his resurrection. He is there. He believes. And what happens? He finds himself before the Sanhedrin. Remember who the Sanhedrin were? They were higher than the Pharisees. They were the leaders of the synagogue, but they were also involved politically. So in other words, they had quite a lot of say in society. And they are summoned to appear before the Sanhedrin. And this is where Peter, after maintaining his relationship with Jesus Christ, speaks out. And the Sanhedrin say, "But we told you not to preach the teachings of Jesus." And Peter says, "I cannot obey that, because I will rather listen to God than listen to human beings." Now, folks, this is something that in a modern day society we all struggle with. We battle to listen to God and obey God, and we battle to turn our ears away from human beings. When a human being tells us to do something and he tells us to jump, we say, how high do you want us to jump? Instead of saying, hang on, what does God want me to do? What does God want me to do? Is this right in the eyes of God? Is this right in line with Scripture? Is this what Jesus wants? But no. We very easily allow ourselves to be misled. We are very gullible to hear what the human beings have to say to us. And we are so worried about what people are going to think about us that we don't even give it a second thought. Yeah, Peter and all the disciples were standing before the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin were actually scolding them and saying, hey, but we told you, we warned you not to do the teachings. But yet the whole of Jerusalem are full of your teachings. And Peter takes the stand and he says, I will rather obey God than obey human beings. Folks, my question to you this morning, Jesus has given you a responsibility to bring his word to all the people, to bring a word of peace to the guilty, to bring a word of hope to the doubters. And I must ask you, is that what you are doing? Are you maintaining your relationship so that you can be that shining light to the nations? Amen. Come, let us pray together. Oh, dear Lord God, we have heard your word to us today, Lord. And Lord, we want to thank you for teaching us today, Lord, for showing us how so often we get it wrong, Lord, how our perceptions and how our understandings are not yours, Lord. Oh, Lord, we thank you for teaching us today. We thank you for allowing your Holy Spirit to work through us. We want to thank you, Lord, for allowing your Holy Spirit to just open our minds and our hearts, Lord, so that we could receive that. Oh, Lord, today we want to pray that you will help us, that we will stop being judgmental, and that we will see the positive in everything that we come into contact with. Let us look for you in every situation. Oh Lord, help us to be like the idiom says, every dark cloud has a silver lining. Help us to look for that silver lining so that we can glorify you, Lord, and bring you all the honor and the glory and exalt your name. So Lord, thank you for teaching us about Thomas. Thank you for teaching us about Peter today. Let us put this into practice as we go into life. Oh Lord, we want to praise you and we want to thank you. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us conclude our service today by professing our faith in Jesus Christ. We join together in singing that wonderful song by the Newsboys, We Believe. We Believe.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe. We this broken generation. When all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations,
folks. That brings us once again to the end of our service today. May I thank you for just allowing me into your place, wherever you may be, just to share the Word of God with you. So receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. And may God bless you with His richest blessing until we meet again. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and never forget that Jesus is only a prayer away. Goodbye now.